Well, how about we begin with the prayer, yes? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So, Lord God, we thank you for this day, all the ways that you work in our lives. Thank you for this time. We ask your grace and blessing upon us as we talk about the church, talk about your plan for our lives. We ask that you would please grant us the grace to understand, to believe, and to love. We ask all this as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay, so we're going to talk, as you can see, about this big question, the fourth question: did Jesus start the Catholic Church? We've been going through, is there truth? What does it mean to say that in matters of religion, there is actual truth that we can find? It's not just opinion or this works for me. There's actually the truth of the way things work. Talked about God's existence, how we can actually prove that, which is pretty epic, obviously, pretty big deal. Divine revelation, we haven't spent a whole lot of time on. We're going to talk about that next time. This question of, has God spoken to us, you know, and the importance of that, how does that work? We've looked at, is Jesus really God? And then we watched a movie about the life of Jesus, just to kind of, you know, instead of just sitting and reading the gospel, which, you know, we can, of course, are encouraged to do, just as a class, we watched a movie that kind of sums it up. Is this guy that walked the face of the earth, that suffered and was crucified and died, did he rise from the dead, and is he God? And if that's the case, well, then we got to follow him, right? If that's God, that's a deal breaker. That's something we can't stand in front of Jesus and say, no. We either call him Lord or we reject him. We have to make a choice about Jesus. And then, once we've gone with that looked at that question, then we look at the last question. Did Jesus start the Catholic Church? Right? That's the reason to be Catholic and not all the other groups out there. And so we're going to talk about that tonight. We're going to look at, what is the Catholic Church? I remember when I was street preaching down at the 16th Street Mall, one of the things we would do when I was studying to be a priest, we'd go down Friday night, 16th Street Mall, stand in the middle of the street, and like read the gospel, like literally just proclaim the gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. We can hand out flyers, hand out sandwiches to the homeless, get into conversations. It was super intense. And so one day I went up to this, these girls came up to me to invite me to their like revival church thing. And they just hand me a flyer and I was like, whoa, wait. And I said, so I'm curious, like, what do you think of when you think, when I say the words Catholic Church, what do you think of the Catholic Church? And the response was very interesting. They said, why do you worship three gods? I was like, what? Three gods? We don't worship three gods. Yeah, you do, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I was like, and thus began a whole conversation about the Trinity. You know, and they were like, no, it's one God, three persons. And they're like, well, where's that in the Bible? It's like, Genesis 1, let us make man in our image, you know? And so that led to a whole conversation. There's lots of misconceptions. Maybe people, you say, what do you think of when you think of Catholicism? Like, why do you guys worship Mary? Well, we don't worship Mary. Why do you guys worship the saints? We don't worship the saints. Oh, it's just a bunch of rules, you know, I don't need religion, I'm spiritual. Well, we're going to talk about those questions, right? Why should someone actually be Catholic rather than just kind of doing their own thing? What does it mean to be Catholic? How do we know Jesus Christ started the Catholic Church? Can we look at the evidence from the life of Christ? Why would Jesus even start a church? We'll look at very Catholic things in the life of Christ and in the scriptures. And we'll look at early Christians who were very clearly Catholic. And then we're going to do a little bit of an overview of the history of Christianity, just a very, very brief. Because that was just something I didn't know growing up. I didn't really know about how this all happened, you know, all religions and Christianity and how that all played out over the last 2,000 years. And that's important. That's relevant. And we'll look at some of the brief difference, a brief look at some of the differences between Catholics and Protestants. Just because those are the two main groups we're familiar with. The Orthodox do exist as well, but we'll talk about that in a minute. So that's what we're going to look at tonight. Okay. Now, I thought I would start with St. Ignatius of Antioch, one of my heroes. I have many saints who are my heroes, just awesome people of faith, which is why we have them in the church. So St. Ignatius of Loyola, St. Ignatius of Antioch, he was a disciple of the apostles. It's believed by many that he was the kid when Jesus, you know, said, "Let the children come to me," that he was the kid that Jesus took into his arms. And so he died in about 110 AD, 107 to 110. And so he wrote many letters, and you can go, they're online, we still have them today, and you can read them. And this is one of the things he said: "See that you all follow the bishop, even as Jesus Christ does the Father, and the presbytery, as you would the apostles, and reverence the deacons as being the institution of God. Let no man do anything connected with the church without the bishop. Let that be deemed a proper Eucharist, which is ministered either by the bishop or by one whom he has entrusted it. Wherever the bishop shall appear, let the multitude of the people also be. Even as wherever Jesus Christ is, there is the Catholic Church." It's a pretty Catholic paragraph, right? Bishops, priests, presbyterate, deacons, Eucharist, Catholic Church. Wherever Jesus Christ is, there is the Catholic Church. This is a guy who lived in the first century, who knew the disciples, who knew the apostles, who may have known Jesus personally. This is what he's writing. So sometimes people claim, the Catholic Church was invented hundreds of years later by Constantine and blah, 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 blah. That's not true. We have clear evidence of Catholic Church first century. First, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, all the way up to where we are today, 2017. Okay, so where are we at in our classes? We've talked about the existence of God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, that there is a God, right? God exists. He created us, and we messed everything up. The world's a mess, right? Adam and Eve fell. They lost grace. They were kicked out of the garden. And so Jesus Christ, the second person of the Trinity, came to earth, took on our humanity, took on a human nature, took on our flesh, became flesh, and died on the cross and rose from the dead to save us from our sins, to save us, right? He is the bridge. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the way to God the Father, because he is in himself the union between God and man. And so that's what we've been talking a lot about. And this question of, did Jesus Christ start the Catholic Church is in this context. Did this happen in his life? Is this willed by him? Okay, so some important questions now. If we believe this, we believe God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, so that all who believe in him might have eternal life. That this is the answer to this. The answer to the fall of mankind. This is God's answer. Christ's death, incarnation, death, and resurrection. Then we've got some important questions. How does that get to everybody? On all the earth, throughout all time. How is this message of Jesus Christ going to get to everyone on earth for all time? How does God make sure the message doesn't get corrupted? Right? Maybe we played a telephone game as a kid, right? You start a little message, and you know, I tell you, and then you tell you, and by the end, just the end of 10 people, the message is completely changed. Right? How does God make sure that doesn't happen with regards to his message of salvation, a pretty important message? You know, we play a telephone game in one line. One sentence gets messed up. Now, his message of salvation, how do we make sure that doesn't get messed up? Is there something more to be communicated than just facts of Jesus Christ and his life? Is God trying to give us more than just knowledge? How does the grace of salvation come to us? This is an important question. Because we know that what God wants for us is not just knowledge, right? It's not just, I want you to know some things and think they're true. He wants to have a relationship with us. And that relationship is going to be supernatural. So how does that supernatural relationship work? How does it get established? How does it be maintained? How does it grow? How do we get to heaven? What about new issues that arise? Right? What about cloning? Is cloning okay? New issues that Jesus never explicitly talked about. Right? Cloning wasn't a possibility back then. What about embryonic stem cell research? What about in vitro fertilization? What about all sorts of things that didn't exist back then? Has God established an authority on earth to deal with those issues? that we can look and establish an authority on earth that we can look to for clear answers? Or is it just everybody's guess? Well, I think this, you think this, Jesus didn't say, so it doesn't matter. I think something as important as human, you know, cloning of human beings is a big deal. You can't just like, it's not in the Bible, so do whatever you want. You know, no, I don't think so. And then it's the last question, does God want an isolated, individualistic relationship with us? Or does he want to be in a relationship with us as a family? That's important. Has he established a family of God? Or is it just individual, me and Jesus, meet anybody, any of you? And that's an important question. I remember one of the first times when I was going through my conversion, I had a conversation with this guy who claimed to be a Christian, and he was very passionate about Jesus, great, awesome. And I asked him, well, where do you go to church? He's like, well, I don't go to church. I just worship God. Like, wait, how does that, like, is that what Jesus wanted? Jesus come to earth, die on a cross, so that everybody would just have their individual relationships with him, not gather together, not worship together, not do anything together. I don't need any of you. Right? Is that what he wanted? Think so. Okay. Now, this, again, my favorite line in the catechism, I'm going to share it again. The whole meaning of life, right? This kind of sums up everything we're talking about. God, infinitely perfect and blessed in himself, in a plan of sheer goodness, freely created man to make him share in his own blessed life, right? What's the meaning of life? To share in the blessed life of God. For this reason, in every time and in every place, God draws close to man. He calls man to seek him, to know him, to love him with all strength. He calls together all men, scattered and divided by sin, into the unity of his family, the church. To accomplish this, when the fullness of time had come, God sent his Son as Redeemer and Savior. In his Son and through him, he invites men to become, in the Holy Spirit, his adopted children and heirs of his blessed life. I mean, that says it all. We're basically going to unpack that paragraph in this class. So I'm going to keep saying it because that's just like, bam, that's the whole thing. Okay, so why do we need a church? Because Jesus established a church. That's a pretty good, easy answer, right? Why do I got to go to church? Why do I have to be a part of a church? Because Jesus gave us one. If he's God, he gives us the church. That's why, you know, why do we need it? Because he said we did. Okay, you know, so there's one argument. Because God calls people together in Christ to share in his own divine life. Right? God calls us to share in his own life, and he calls us together into a family. And to preserve throughout time the deposit of faith and the means of salvation Jesus gave us. So all the truth that Jesus wanted to us to know, all the truth that God has revealed has to be preserved, and all the grace has to be transmitted. And so the church exists to preserve both. Truth and grace. If we only had the Bible and fallible, imperfect interpreters who could be wrong, we wouldn't stay in the truth. Right? Because some people say, well, just you have to have the Bible. That's what you have. That's all you need. We don't need a church. I don't need religion. I don't need the Catholic Church. I just need the Bible. Well, that's kind of like finding a person on the top of a roof and say, oh, that person doesn't need ladder anymore. He only got there because of the ladder. Right? Who put the Bible together? The Catholic Church did. The 200 and 300s. We're the ones that gave the world the Bible. It's our book. And we'll talk more about that next time. But people have this idea that, well, I just take my Bible. That's all I need. I don't need religion. I don't need this church. I don't need to gather together. I just read my Bible. Again, the Bible explicitly says we shouldn't do that. That's so contrary to the very nature of where that book came from. Contrary to the nature of the entire Old and New Testament. But the problem, the core issue with that is you have infallible book and fallible, that is without error, and person who can be wrong, who is with error, what are you going to get? Infallible book that is read by a fallible, imperfect person, you're going to get imperfect results. Doesn't matter how perfect that book is, you're not perfect. You're infallible, you can be wrong, you are going to have errors. Well, I think it means this. And this is why, for example, there's 30,000, 33,000 types of Protestants. Because they read the Bible, this guy reads the Bible and says, I think it means this, about how to get to heaven, is baptism necessary? Well, I think it means this, and I don't think baptism is necessary. Well, we can't agree. I think it means this, you think it means this. There's no guy to settle the, there's no dad to settle the, mom or dad to settle the debate, so they go off and found their own religions. Is that what Jesus wanted? To just read a book, can't decide, form your own religions? I don't think so. But that's what happens in Protestantism, not in Catholicism. And it's not, again, it's not just about information, it's also about grace. And how's that grace being communicated? Okay, so, now there was a video a while back that went viral, was very popular, and it's the title is, Why I Love Jesus But Hate Religion. And it was a whole rap on this guy who says he's a Christian, says he loves Jesus, but that Jesus hated religion. And so we can ask, some people claim that Jesus hated religion is all about a relationship and being spiritual. And they're like, oh, religion just makes wars, religion's the cause of all the problems on the earth. I got into a whole long discussion about that with somebody. I was walking down the street just praying a rosary and he just went after, oh, religion causes all the problems. And I was like, no, bad religion causes problems. If everybody in the world was a super devout Catholic radically in love with Jesus Christ, there would not be wars. There would not be poverty and homelessness. There would not be any of the problems that is afflicting people. Maybe we would still have natural disasters, but we'd have a massive amount of people there ready to help, right? It's bad religion. It's false religion, or people not being faithful to the religion that God has established is the real problem. It's not religion. It's bad religion. Or unfaithful, infidelity. So, how many of us have heard this line though? Well, I'm not religious, I'm spiritual. Okay, well, let's look at that. Is that even possible? Now, the word religion comes from the Latin re liare, which means to bind together, to rebind together. And, which we of course know that means to rebind together man to God. So what does it take to connect God and man? That's religion. Religion is the way to connect God and man, to bind man to God. And so, in any religion, what are you going to have? You're going to have a set of beliefs to which one holds, faith, believe these things, right? We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, Jesus Christ, the only Son, our Lord. You're going to have a way of living, a morality. Do this, don't do this. You're going to have a way of interacting with God, worship. This is how you should pray. This is what you should do to interact with God. This is how you should get your sins forgiven. This is what you need to do. Any of the religions on the earth, that's what you're going to have. And any type of spirituality, you're going to have that too. Any type of relationship with God and belief system could be categorized as a religion. And so it's just nonsensical to say, I'm spiritual but not religious. No, you're just your own religion. You have a religion. It's just made up by you and changeable. So the question is, did God reveal the truth about himself and how to be in a relationship with him? If yes, that's religion. And that includes the relationship. Right? They create this dichotomy, this false dichotomy that says Jesus hates religion and it's about a relationship. It's not about the religion, it's about the relationship. No, religion is about the relationship. Relationship has rules. Any relationship has rules, right? You have rules in marriage, right? They may be unspoken rules. Don't punch me in the face and kill me in my sleep. That's a pretty easy to understand rule of marriage, right? You don't marry the person thinking, I just never know, they're going to kill me in my sleep. No, you're pretty confident when you marry the person. That's a kind of unspoken rule. You don't need to write that down. Parents and kids, unspoken rule, torture us, all those things. Every relationship has rules, ways of treating each other, things that are respectful and not respectful. Oh, religion's just about rules. Every relationship has rules. Every relationship has, quote unquote, revelation, things that you learn about who the other is. Right? In a marital relationship, you're sharing each other's hearts. What are you thinking about? What's on your heart? What do you think about this? What do you think about that? There's that revealing of self in every relationship. I'm just spiritual. That's all about the relationship, not about the religion. I'm sorry, that doesn't make sense. It's like saying square circle. Religion is about the relationship, and every relationship has rules. Okay, so now we're going to look at how this all happened. How do we know Jesus started the Catholic Church? Okay, so we know, we talked about before, Jesus' mission. He's sent by the Father to do what? To save souls, to save us from sin and to restore us to communion with God. To fix the original problem, the fall of mankind, the break of communion with God. And so we see this. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Right? God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. He created us for divine adoption. He created us to share in the very sonship of Jesus Christ. And when he comes to earth, he calls apostles. He calls 12 people to be with him and gives them authority that he doesn't give to other people. He speaks to them in ways that he doesn't speak to other people. He chooses 12 apostles. And we see this. He appointed 12 to be with him and to be sent out to preach and have authority to cast out demons. Jesus said to them again, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I send you. Right after he rose from the dead, he shares his mission with the apostles in the upper room. And he gives them this authority, this huge authority, to speak in his name. He who hears you, hears me. And he who rejects you, rejects me. And he who rejects me, rejects him who sent me. That's a big deal. Right? For Jesus to say, if anyone rejects what you're saying, they're rejecting God. You're going to speak with that level of authority. You're going to be my voice. What we'll say, like, we'll call vicar of Christ, the voice of Christ. Okay? So, this one of the big scenes at the middle of his mission, or at a culminating point in his mission, happened in Caesarea Philippi, where Jesus says to the apostles, well, who do people say that the Son of Man is? And they're like, well, some say you're John the Baptist, or Elijah, or Jeremiah, one of the prophets. But then Jesus says, but who do you say that I am? And Simon says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus says to him, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the powers of death shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. So Jesus is starting a church. He is starting a church. I will build my church, and the powers of hell, the powers of death shall not prevail against it. The church that Jesus Christ established has been here for 2,000 years, and it will be here until he returns. And a good question we could ask is that just a nebulous group of somewhat like-minded believers who all think basically different things? Is that a nebulous people of who think pleasant thoughts about Jesus? Is that what he meant by church? Or is it an actual visible group, a visible structure, a visible thing, a city set on a hill, built on a rock, that the gates of hell cannot prevail? Okay? So we're going to say, yes, it's Catholic Church, 2,000 years. We've been here. What do you say? I give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. You got the keys to something. You have authority over that something, right? Keys to my car? I give you the keys to my car, you can drive the car. Right? Keys to the house? You can get in the house. No, you have authority there. Keys to the kingdom of heaven? Right? That's why when you see pictures of Peter, he's always got keys with him, you know. When you hear jokes about St. Peter, is that Peter's at the gate and somebody comes in, why is he at the gate? Well, he's got the keys, you know. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. That's a big statement. If Peter says, guys, this is how it is. That's how it is. God honors that. That's a huge statement. Okay? Jesus gives the apostles power of binding and loosing. He gives them an authority, and we'll call it an apostolic authority, this authority from the apostles. To Peter himself, we just looked at that. And then in two chapters later, in Matthew 18, he gives it to all the apostles as a group together. Whatever you bind on earth should be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth should be loosed in heaven. And then the Holy Spirit is sent to the apostles to keep the faith, to keep them in the truth. They're given this mission, but if it was just up to them on a human level, that would be horrible, right? Okay, you're going to speak with my authority, go. No, they're given power. They're given the Holy Spirit to guard them, to keep them in the truth. Jesus said, "These things I've spoken to you while I'm still with you, but the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I've said to you." They're going to have the Holy Spirit to keep them from messing things up. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. Okay, so they're going to have the Holy Spirit to help them, to guide them, to keep them in the truth. And so what do? They speak with the authority of the Holy Spirit. They know their mission. They're not just like, "Hey guys, Jesus, he's awesome, and here's some things we think about him, but you know, we're just ordinary people, so you know, believe what you want." No, they speak with the authority of the Holy Spirit. This is what must be believed. They say this: "It seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these necessary things." You got to follow these things. And it says, "And they went on their way through the cities. They delivered to them for observance the decisions which had been reached by the apostles and elders who were at Jerusalem." For observance, not as a suggestion, but as observance. You guys got to follow this. So, what do we see? We see the church is like this big ship, this ark, like Noah's Ark, preserving Christ's revelation and grace. And we see this in 1 Timothy 3:15. This is one of the passages I like to pull out sometimes when people are kind of trying to convert me and they're on the attack. I'll say, "So what is the pillar and foundation of truth for God's word?" What is the pillar and foundation of truth? And they're like, "Well, the Bible." And say, actually, 1 Timothy 3:15 says it's the church. The church of the living God, the pillar and bulwark of truth. 1 Timothy 3:15. And can a nebulous group of people that don't believe the same thing, you know, can that be a pillar? No, it's not. It's a blob. It's not a pillar. So I was going to say, no, there's the church is something. It's both visible and spiritual. It's a city set on a hill. It cannot be hidden. Okay. So, let's review. Jesus' mission. He's sent by the Father to save us from sin and restore us to communion with God. Jesus shares his mission and authority with the apostles. He chooses them. He gives the apostles power of binding and loosing, this apostolic authority. The Holy Spirit is sent to the apostles to keep the faith. And the apostles speak with the authority of the Holy Spirit. You see all this happening in the Gospels. Right? So Jesus came to die for us, die for our sins, but he also came to establish the kingdom of God so that his cross, his truth, his revelation could be communicated. And when people experience his salvation, it makes them members of the kingdom. So, now, the next question is, Father, okay, the apostles had this mission, but once they died, it kind of ended with them, right? That's what our Protestant brothers and sisters would say, that it ended with the apostles. Once John died, all that authority went out the window. That's not true. They handed on their mission to others. Entrusted with the mission of Christ, the apostles hand on their mission to their successors, the people who take their place. We see this in the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1. Judas betrayed Jesus, right? One of the 12. And he hung himself. And so right after Jesus ascends into heaven, what happens? First thing they do, they choose a successor for Judas. They give the apostolic ministry to Matthias in place of Judas. And they quote a scripture: "His office let another take." His office let another take. So they see being an apostle not as something exclusive to the 12, but something that is an office that can be passed on. This apostolic office. Paul, we know, is made an apostle, even though he doesn't have the original qualifications that the apostles are mentioned in Acts of the Apostles. Paul calls himself an apostle. And then Paul speaks to Timothy, a bishop: "Follow the pattern of sound words which you have heard from me, in the faith and love which are in Christ Jesus. Guard the truth that has been entrusted to you by the Holy Spirit who dwells within us. So here, Timothy, Paul's recognizing that the truth has been entrusted to him by the Holy Spirit. And what says, what you have heard from me before many witnesses, entrust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. And we see this, when they had appointed elders, or presbyters, we get priests, presbyteroi in Latin Greek, they appointed elders for them in every church with prayer and fasting, they committed them to the Lord in whom they believed. So we see them establishing successors. And we see in the scriptures qualifications for bishops, priests, and deacons. In 1 Timothy 3:15, we see that gift is conferred by the laying on of hands, which is where ordination rite, how I became a priest, his bishop put hands on my head, a bishop who was ordained by a bishop, 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 all the way back to the apostles. That's how that power was passed on. So, the hierarchy of the church is the same as it was in Jesus' day and in the time of the apostles. Head of the Catholic Church, obviously, is God, Jesus Christ himself, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the persons of the Trinity. Son of God established the Catholic Church. And he set up Peter to be the first pope, the leader of the apostles. We see Peter talking more than all the other apostles combined. He's given authority of binding and loosing himself. And now we still have the successor to St. Peter, Pope Francis, the 266th pope. We have the 12 apostles, who were the first bishops of the Catholic Church. And now we have lots of bishops. 5,358, last time I looked. Probably more than that now. Lots of bishops. Because the Catholic Church has spread from a few hundred to 1.3 billion. So, a lot more bishops. Priests and deacons, we see that in the New Testament. Bishops, priests, and deacons. And we have priests today. 414,000 Catholic priests, about 42,000 deacons. And that would be a question we could ask someone who's not Catholic and say, well, where are your bishops, priests, and deacons? Where's your successor to St. Peter? Like, you don't have all those things that are there in the New Testament. That's a problem. If Jesus gave us that, we can't just throw those out the window. Those are from Jesus. Okay. Now, when we can look at the writings of the early church fathers, we have writings from the New Testament. We want to say, were these people Catholic? Is the Catholic Church, can it show that it exists in the first century? Yes, we can. These are just some. The Didache, which is the writing of the apostles, St. Clement of Rome, one of the first popes, St. Ignatius of Antioch, who I talked about, St. Polycarp, who I'll talk about at the end, St. Justin Martyr, St. Irenaeus of Lyon, Eusebius of Caesarea, he wrote a church history, St. John Chrysostom, St. Jerome. There are many. You can go to newadvent.org/fathers and just read the writings, and you're like, these guys were so clearly Catholic, it's crazy. So clearly. And many of them just call themselves that. Okay, so, we look in the scriptures, we look at what Jesus did while in his life, we see that there are certain characteristics, what we'll call marks, of the church that Jesus established. Certain characteristics of the church that Jesus established. First, the church is one, which means it's unique. There's only one. Jesus didn't establish 15 different religions. He didn't establish a million religions. He didn't establish 33,000 religions. He started one church. In 33 AD, if you wanted to be a part of the church that Jesus established, you had to be connected to the apostles. You had to be connected to the people that were connected to the apostles. That's how it worked. And it's united. So it's one, because of her source, founder, and soul. The founder, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And so we know that there's one Lord. Jesus didn't establish many different religions for many different gods. He established one religion, because there's only one God. He confesses one faith in the words that Jesus, faith in God and what he communicated to us. Right? It's not just a lot of different opinions. One baptism forms only one body, is given life by the one Spirit for the sake of one hope. And this is Ephesians chapter 4. So the church is one. The church is holy. Holy, what does it mean? It means it is sanctified by God and it's set apart for God. or think of a chalice, right? Something is sacred, something is holy, it's set apart for God. It's holy because of her author. God is holy. Christ, her bridegroom, gave himself up to make the church holy. The spirit of holiness gives her life. You say, but Father, there's lots of sinners in the church. I was like, yeah. You know, I was having a conversation with a lady recently, and like, oh, you know, she's going to daily mass, and like, people are saying, you're so holy, you go to church every day. It's like, no, that's the reason I go to church every day. I'm not holy. I want to be holy. Like, the church is the hospital. Like, we're here for the answers. And so you say, well, how can I be Catholic if all these sinners in the church, right? Oh, I don't need to go to church on Sunday. They're just a bunch of hypocrites. And I'd be like, yeah, you'll fit right in. And where the church is in itself, its teachings are perfect. Christ, of course, our Lord God is perfect. There are sinners in the church for the medicine, right? We don't judge the truth of the church based on the sinfulness of its members. That's like judging the medicine based on the people who are sick. Like, they got to take the medicine, you know? Those who take the medicine become saints, right? You want to judge Catholicism, look at St. Mother Teresa, St. Padre Pio, St. John Paul II, St. Francis, St. Clare. We look at the saints of the church. We want to judge the efficacy or the effectiveness of the medicine of Catholicism. And of course, in Mary, she's already all holy. Mary was sinless. And so, I remember one time I got into a conversation with a girl who had left the church, and she was in this other religion, and she was so surprised that she found a Catholic who loved Jesus. I'm like, yeah, I love Jesus. It's like, yeah, I know lots of people that love Jesus who are Catholic. And she's like, I just never thought that was possible. It's like, I don't know how you grew up. Like, that just sounds sad to me. That, you know, maybe she had this experience of religion. She'd go to church on Sunday and it was boring and no one interacted with her because she's a kid or whatever. I don't know. Maybe some people who were claiming to be Catholic stabbed her in the back and hurt her. I don't know. But living Catholicism is very beautiful. You know, dead Catholicism, where people say they're Catholic and don't do anything that Jesus says, that's pretty tragic. It's like the worst of the tragedies to be a dead Catholic. But living Catholicism is beautiful. It changes the world. The church is Catholic. So what does the word Catholic mean? The word Catholic, Catholicos, means universal. But it means universal not in two senses. In the sense of according to the totality and in keeping with the whole. So she has the fullness of faith and the full means of salvation. So sometimes when people think Catholic, it means spread throughout the whole world, which is true. It's universal in the sense that it's open to everybody. It's not just like in the Old Testament with Judaism, where you had to be, for the most part, born into the Jewish faith to be Jewish. Sometimes you have some God-fearing people. But no, it's universal. It's open to everybody. God said, Jesus said, go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I'm with you always until the end of the age, to the close of the age. So he sent out the church to the whole world, to all people, for all time. But Catholic also means to hold to all of it, to hold to the totality of it, like the whole kit and caboodle. So when someone says, well, I'm Catholic, but I don't believe this, this, and this, that doesn't make sense. That's like saying square circle. To me, be Catholic means you hold to all of it. Because the second you take out one piece of Catholicism and say, I don't believe this, you've destroyed the very foundation of Catholicism. Either it's from God, and the teachings are true, or no one, and everybody should be Catholic, or some of the teachings aren't true, you can't trust any of it, and no one on this earth should be Catholic. That's how we see things, is this is not just, well, I think of this, this, and this. Right? There's no such thing as a cafeteria Catholic. That's called Protestantism. Catholicism means to hold to all of it. Then we'll talk more about why that is, because we believe that the teachings are from God and they're perfect and they're without error and they're preserved without error. Okay. And the church is apostolic. She's founded on the apostles in three ways. The origin, she was actually founded on actual apostles.
And that church that was established on the apostles will remain to the end of time. Maintenance, with the help of the Holy Spirit, the church preserves the teachings of the apostles without error. That's important, without error. And mission, she continues to be taught, sanctified, and guided by the successors of the apostles, the Pope and the bishops. So they're still at work, the successors to the apostles. Okay, so, now, we looked at that. Church is one holy, Catholic, and apostolic. We say that in the creed, I believe, one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. So what could be a definition for the church? The church is the congregation, the gathering together, of all those who profess the faith of Christ, partake of the same sacraments, and are governed by the lawful pastors under one visible head. So we want to be a part of the church that Jesus established. We've got to be part of the faith that Christ gave us. We've got to hold that. Take of the same sacraments that Christ gave us and governed by the lawful authority that Christ has given us. Same faith. The Catholic Church hasn't changed its teachings for 2,000 years. It can't. They're from Christ. The same sacraments, and there are seven of the sacraments. And the same authority, which is the Pope and the bishops, what we call the magisterium of the church. And so that's what it means to be Catholic. We hold to the faith that Christ gave us. We receive the graces through the sacraments that Christ gave us, and we're under the same authority that Christ gave us. We take those, some of those out. I always want Jesus. I'm sorry, that's not, you can't love the king and hate the kingdom. You can't say, I want the king in my life, but on my terms. Yeah, king, I don't want this part. I don't want that part. I don't want this part. That's not, then he's not your king. No, then you're king. And Jesus is your co-pilot instead of your pilot, right? Jesus is the co-pilot. Change seats. Okay. Or another way of saying this, it's a bigger way of saying this, the Lumen Gentium. Where is the church, Christ Church today? This is the Church of Christ, which in the Creed is professed as one holy Catholic and apostolic, which our Savior, after his resurrection, commissioned Peter to shepherd, and him and the other apostles to extend and direct with authority, which he erected for all ages as the pillar and mainstay of truth. This church, constituted and organized in the world as a society, subsists in the Catholic Church, which is governed by the successor of Peter, Pope, and by the bishops in communion with him. Although many elements of sanctification and truth are found outside of its visible structures, these elements, as gifts belonging to the Church of Christ, are forces impelling towards Catholic unity. So someone asked the question, well, does that mean all other Christian groups are evil and wrong? No, they're not. They have pieces of the truth to various degrees, obviously, because they disagree. But those pieces of the truth are from us. They wouldn't have them without the Catholic Church. And they those pieces of the truth should be leading them to Catholicism, which is what we see. We see lots of non-Catholics becoming Catholics, lots of even ministers, Protestant ministers becoming Catholic. People like Scott Hahn and Alex Jones and Jeff Cavins and so many others. There's a whole website for Protestant pastors who want to become Catholic. So, Catholicism. Let's look it up. Sum it up here. What do we believe is Catholicism? What do we have? First, the Holy Trinity, right? That God has revealed that he's one God, three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, right? That's a Catholic belief. We believe in divine revelation, that God has spoken and interacted with humanity, has communicated stuff, he's communicated his word to us on faith and morals. And that's going to be passed down to us through sacred scripture and sacred tradition. And we have to have both. God didn't just drop a Bible from the sky. He spoke to prophets. He handed on that tradition, that tradere. And if we look at the Bible and we say, well, what does this mean? Well, that's sacred tradition. How do we interpret? The correct interpretation of the Bible is sacred tradition. We'll talk more about that next time. He gave us an apostolic authority and with succession, an apostolic succession. The magisterium, the teaching authority of the church, the Pope and the bishops. Right? Peter and the apostles, now Pope and bishops. And he gave us bishops, priests, and deacons. He gave us sacraments, which we're going to talk about. Baptism, confirmation, Holy Communion, confession, holy orders, marriage, and anointing of the sick. He gave us the holy sacrifice of the Mass. We'll talk about that, how to worship him through the holy sacrifice of the Mass. And he gave us his family, the Blessed Virgin Mary and the saints. And so, you know, people say, oh, I don't need any of that, I just want Jesus. But this is not a minimalistic thing. We don't have a minimalistic God, right? Yes, our number one is relationship with the Most Holy Trinity, and then everything he's given us to help us in our relationship with the Most Holy Trinity. It would be tragic to say, I don't want any of that, I just want God. But these are gifts from God to help us get to God. These, just throw those out the window, yeah, that's tragic. So you say, I just want my mom. I don't want to hear anything she has to say. I don't want to receive any wisdom from her. I don't want to receive any hugs. I just want her in my life. Like, that's a weird relationship, right? No, God loves us. To have a relationship with him, he's going to talk to us. He's going to communicate stuff. And he's going to have grace to give us to bring us into communion with him. And that's called the church. And that's called divine revelation. That's called the kingdom of God. Okay, so a little church history. Jesus Christ started the church 33 AD. Right? He born, lived 33 years, died on the cross, rose from the dead. And when he was here, he established the kingdom of God. One of the first things he says when he starts his mission, he says, the kingdom of God is at hand. The time of fulfillment is here. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. And so for the first 1,000 years, if you believed in Jesus, you were Catholic. There were little groups, little heresies that would sprout up. Heresies like Arianism, this group of people that thought Jesus wasn't God, he was kind of a lesser being, or Nestorianism, that Jesus was two beings, or two persons, or all sorts of other heresies. Was Nestorianism two persons? I don't know. Can't remember now. Sabellianism or modalism, that God was not three persons but one person, and he's just wearing different masks, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. There's lots of little heresies that would sprout up that the church would say, wrong answer, gather in council, this is not correct, don't believe this, this is the truth. Right? That's what happens. Just like it did in the Acts of the Apostles, and people were getting confused. Do we have to keep all the Mosaic law? Do people have to be circumcised? Do we have to do all these things in the Old Testament? And the apostles gathered together and said, no, Jesus fulfilled the law, so we still have to be moral, of course. This is what we need to do. We need to be baptized. We need to believe, and be baptized and follow the good news of Jesus Christ. And they spoke with the authority of the apostles. Or the authority of the Holy Spirit. 1,000 years later, in 1054, the Orthodox Church, so the eastern part of Catholicism, in Constantinople, or now Istanbul, basically broke away and said, we want to do our own thing, we don't want to be under the authority of the Pope. We excommunicate you. And then the Pope excommunicated them, and there's a big rift. And if you look at all people who have some type of belief in Jesus Christ, it's about a little over 2 billion people. More than half of that is Catholic, 1.3 billion. 500 million is Orthodox. And the Orthodox believe about 95% of the same things we do. So it's interesting that 75% of all Christians believe most of what we believe. It's just we don't live in a Catholic country. And so we experience a lot of Protestantism. But they don't accept the authority of the Pope. They believe in divorce. They still have 7 sacraments, they still have bishops and priests and deacons, the Eucharist. But they broke away in 1054, the Great Schism. And then in the 1500s, how did I go 21 years on earth without even knowing this? Like, I guess I just kind of, I never even thought about it. Like, oh, there's different Christian groups. Yeah, how did that all happen? I never even thought about it. Well, in 1517, Martin Luther, who was a Catholic priest and an Augustinian monk, he stapled his 95 thesis to church door and rebelled and broke away from the Catholic Church and started his whole own group, which we call Lutheranism today. And then other groups, other people like John Calvin and, of course, another big one, Henry VIII. Henry VIII was the king of England, and in 1534 he wanted to marry someone else because Catherine of Aragon, his wife, couldn't give him a child, was barren. And so he wanted to divorce her, get an annulment, and marry Anne Boleyn. And the Catholic Church said, no, you're not going to do that. You can't just toss her aside because she can't have kids. That's not a reason. And so he rebelled. He said, He declared himself the head of the church, declared himself the head of the Church of England, and started killing Catholic bishops and priests and nuns and any Catholics who opposed him. You had to sign the Act of Supremacy, and if you didn't, you would get your head chopped off or get tortured viciously or get thrown in prison. And this happened. St. John, John Fisher, St. Thomas More, the Chancellor of England, all were martyred for the faith, and this became a very bloody time in the church, where if you were Catholic, you were risking your life living in England, and most of you would get tortured and killed. And so, this is called the Protestant Reformation, or what we might call the Protestant Revolt. Protestant thinking of protests, they're protesting things. And then from there, just splintered. And now we have the 33,000 types of Protestant groups, Protestant denominations today. 33,830, according to one study. Because if they can't agree on something, they just form different religions. Baptists, Methodists, you know, First Church of this, Church of God in Christ, Pentecostal Church, and Pentecostal Church, you know, boom, 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 boom. And now we have non-denominational churches, which are basically every church becomes its own religion, based on what this guy says. We're non-denominational. That just means you're your own denomination, because that guy comes up with your belief system, and you just have to presume he's right. Man, that's terrifying. So, I just put down there just kind of an overview of some key differences. We'll look at a lot of these issues in detail over the classes, but just kind of in a breakdown of what are the key differences between Catholics and Protestants. One is in the issue of revelation. You know, Protestants are going to believe that it's just the Bible. There's no authority on earth that God has established. You just have to read the Bible and figure it out yourself. And we'd say, no, God has established not only the scriptures, but also sacred tradition, the correct interpretation of the scriptures, and he's established an infallible magisterium, a group of people who have authority to speak in his name. He who hears you hears me. Salvation, how do we actually get to heaven? We believe that it's through that original sin is the loss of sanctifying grace. That's how we lost our salvation. We lost the grace of salvation, the grace that was giving us a supernatural communion with God. And so salvation comes from by getting that grace back, getting sanctifying grace back, which happens through faith and baptism. We can be lost by mortal sin and get back by going to confession. This is where the sacraments come in, the sacraments of the church. Whereas Protestants don't believe in any of that. They'd say, no, once man fell, it became totally deprived of all goodness, totally corrupt. There's nothing you can do to fix that. You're totally deprived of goodness, not even in the image of God anymore. And so salvation is by as a covering. You accept Jesus as Lord, and he covers you in his blood. You accept him through faith alone. Sola fide. And depending on what denomination you are, that may be able to be lost or may not be able to be lost. Some people say you can't lose your salvation. You could go kill millions of people and you'll still get to heaven. We'd say, that's crazy. That's so contrary to the scriptures, but who will believe that? And then the sacraments, that God actually gave us these physical realities that confer grace, outward signs instituted by Christ to give grace. And there are seven sacraments, especially in one of the great sacraments, the source and summit of our faith, the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist. That the night before he died, he changed bread and wine into his very body and blood. Whereas Protestants would say no. At most, they'll say there are two sacraments. Baptism, some groups believe in baptism, some don't. And then marriage, although they allow for divorce, we don't believe in divorce. We don't believe you can divide what God has united. And then for them, communion is simply symbolic. It's just eating bread. It's not the body of Christ. There might be some groups that say they believe in something like the body of Christ, but they wouldn't have it because they don't have a priesthood. So we'll talk about that more later. In the Catholic Church, we're going to have clear teachings on morality. Teachings on morality that are infallible, which means they're without error. Infallibly taught by the church, rooted in natural law and divine revelation that you can build a house on, that this is true. In Protestantism, you're going to get a wide variety of opinions on morality from individual biblical interpretations. You're going to have some Protestant groups that are going to say, I remember I had a conversation with a couple in RCIA who their Protestant minister told them it was okay for them to live together and have sex outside of marriage. And I'm like,
didn't he read in the Bible, fornicators don't go to heaven? Like, fornicators won't inherit the kingdom of God? Like, that's explicit in the scriptures. Like, he just throws that out. Or people that think that, you know, abortion is okay. There are Protestant groups, there are Christian groups that think that it's okay to kill an unborn baby. Like, what? No, thou shalt not kill. This is what you get. You get just people's opinions. Well, I think the Bible means this. I think the Bible means that. Like, I think God wanted to set it up so we wouldn't do that. So we'd be like, we wouldn't just say, well, I think this. Well, yeah, that's pretty convenient. No, no, this is the truth. And then the other one is the saints. As Catholics, we see Mary, the Mother of God, as our mother. And we can pray to the saints. We can talk to the saints and pray for the souls in purgatory. Whereas Protestants, there's no contact with the deceased, including the saints, Blessed Mother in heaven, can't interact with any of them, and there's no such thing as purgatory. They don't believe in purgatory. So those are some of the differences. There's lots more, and there are lots more specific differences, but that's just kind of an overview, like I said, I'd give. Okay. Oops. And left that out of the picture. So divine revelation and authority, original sin, salvation and grace, sacraments, morality, and saints. Those are some of the big differences. Okay, so why is this important? Jesus founded one church that is both spiritual and material, visible and invisible. He said, you know, a city set on a hill cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and puts it under a bushel basket. Set on a lampstand and we give light. You know, you are the light of the world. And so the church is going to be visible, right? When he talks about wise man builds his house on rock so that when the storms come, the waves, the rain hits and buffets the house, it's going to stand. Wise man, a fool, builds his house on sand. And Jesus builds his house on rock. The word rock, Petros, is, you know, Jesus. When Jesus says, you are Peter, and on this rock I'll build my church, Peter means rock. That's what the word means. If we love Jesus, we have to love his bride, the church. You can't love the king and hate the kingdom. It's part together, right? Can't say, oh, I love this guy. I can't stand his wife and kids, man. Like, you got problems with that guy then. They're united, right? It's a package deal. Christianity isn't just about me and Jesus. Yes, God wants an intimate, personal, profound, amazing, radically intimate, radically loving, direct relationship with us. And he wants us to have a relationship with all of his family, too. And he wants us to receive his revelation. Not just privately, God spoke to me. Because that is so capable of being messed up, right? We are sinful people. Can you imagine betting your entire salvation on your ability alone to correctly hear God's voice in every matter? Can you imagine betting your eternal salvation on that? That sounds terrifying. I'm a sinful person. Well, God said I could do this. Wink, wink. You know, that's, you know, like, really? What happens when, well, God said I could do this. God told me you can't. Bam. Fight. No, there's God established a kingdom, so we wouldn't be fighting with that. The hierarchy of the church has been established by Christ to protect the treasures of the kingdom. It's not to lord it over. The greatest among you must be your servants, right? The Pope is called the servant of the servants of God. And so the church has been established, this authority, to protect divine revelation, to know the truth that sets us free, and the sacraments, the graces of salvation. So why should we be Catholic? Because Jesus started the Catholic Church. That's number one. Because Catholicism has the fullness of truth and grace that sets us free. It is rocket fuel for intimacy with Jesus Christ. Catholicism most reveals the love of God. You know, I got into a conversation once with a guy who was, I can't remember if he was Catholic and left the church or was never Catholic, I can't remember. And he had this, he's got this weird, like he was, like, no, you just have the Bible, that's all you have, that's all you need. Like, that doesn't reveal the love of God very much to me, right? God just drops a book from the sky and says, read this and find the way. I mean, that's not how it happened, of course. God chose people, individuals who were part of a group called the Catholic Church and prophets before them, part of the Old Testament, people of Israel. That's not how it happened. God didn't drop a book from the sky.
Catholic Church put the Bible together, so it's pretty unhistorical. They say, what reveals more the love of God? God just handing you a book and say, read this, figure it out, good luck. If you get it wrong, you're burned in hell. Or God establishes a church, a kingdom on this earth, and for 2,000 years protects it, even though every single member, except for the Blessed Virgin Mary and Jesus, were sinners, and some radical sinners, that he protects the church. He says, this is the grace. These are the means of salvation, baptism, sacraments. This is all the things that I want you to know. This is the truth that sets you free. And I'm going to establish a kingdom, a visible kingdom on this earth to go change the world. Not just a bunch of individuals doing their own thing, but an actual church, an actual kingdom that has a mission to convert the whole world and has grace and power and truth. That's beautiful. That's awesome. Well, thank you, Jesus. I think I remember when, I think I've told you, when one of my friends who became a Protestant minister was, I was at the beginnings of my, I was at a moment of my conversion, and he just handed me a Bible and like, this is all you need. I'm like that just seems terrifying to me. Like, here's the Bible, read it yourself, and you better be smart enough to figure it out, because you can't trust anybody else's interpretation, because you're just, why should you believe them? That's putting your faith in man, you know? Why should you believe anything they say versus me? Like, that just seems like such an avenue of pride. I will figure it all out myself, me and God, we got this. I'm a sinful person. I think God loves me more than that. I think God loves me more than just to hand me a book and say, figure it out, and don't mess it up. You know, I think he loves me enough to establish a kingdom so that I can, so we can teach with a surety that this stuff is true to even children. Catholicism is a saint maker. Right? Yes, there's lots of sinners who have claimed the name Catholic, but that's not Catholic. Catholic Church doesn't teach people to sin. Yes, even bishops, priests, and popes have committed great sins, but that's not Catholicism. That's betraying Catholicism. You don't judge a medicine based on the ones who don't take it. Right? You judge it based on the ones who do, and they're called the saints. And man, they are some awesome people, because Catholicism is true. Okay, so, any questions?
When you were talking, oh, I'm sorry. No, go ahead, raise your mouth. When you were talking about the difference between Protestant and non-denominational churches, you said something that I missed, and it was a point. What was the non-denominational church?
So, non-denominational means that they're not connected to any bigger group, which basically, what most people would say is that means they're their own denomination.
Okay.
That they become their own religion unto themselves, because they say, well, we just believe in the basics of Christianity. Well, what is that? And that ends up being, we follow what this guy says, this pastor of this individual church. He thinks baptism is necessary, so we baptize. He thinks baptism is not necessary, so we don't baptize. So that's the danger of non-denominational. It becomes its own denomination.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And something on the history of the church, like in the 15th century, there was a schism within the church, so that we had a pope in France and a pope in Rome. How did that happen, and how did that get resolved, do you know?
It's kind of a long historical question. So there was a time, I don't know if it was in the 1500s or the 14 or 1300s, but where there were three people at one time claiming to be pope.
Three.
And there was obviously only one pope. Anybody can claim. There's two or three people right now claiming to be pope. There's some guy in like Wyoming or Montana or somebody that thinks he's the pope. But Pope Michael has a website, you know.
Okay.
You know, so anybody can claim to be pope. But there's only one guy who's pope.
Mm-hmm.
How they resolved it was they all died or resigned. And then there was an election of a new pope.
Mm-hmm.
So... yeah, I mean, it can go into more of the historical details, but I'm thinking, okay, I got 8 minutes, I want to show you some videos, so I might prepare a little answer next time that's a little bit better for that. But the short version is, they either died or resigned, and a new pope was elected. They all basically agreed to get out of the way. Any other questions? Okay, so two quick things, two saints. I'll talk about St. Polycarp of Smyrna, the great
right? So when he's, I've never baptized, oh, hi, Polycarp, how you doing? It's a great saint. Maybe not the best name right now, but he lived in 69 AD to 155 AD. We have his martyrdom, the martyrdom of Polycarp. You want to read a story about some guy with some guts, man. This guy was tough. So he was a bishop of Smyrna. They wrote a martyrdom. They wrote his martyrdom. There's a great line that's just so awesome that he was 86 years old, I think, at the time, and he was they had come to kill him. They were killing Christians, right? You're Catholic, they're gonna kill you. It's illegal to be Catholic. And so they come to arrest him, and he's like, hey, why don't you let me cook you a meal first? You know, and so they let him make a meal. So, since I fed you, why don't you let me pray a little bit? So then he prays for like 2 hours until they finally like, we gotta go. And so they take him in front of the judge, and the judge is like, hey, you know, just renounce Christ, just burn some incense, just do some things. I mean, think of your old age, you know. You know, we'll give you all these things if you just betray Christ. And this is one of the things he said. You threaten me with fire, which burns for an hour and is extinguished, but you know nothing of the fire of the coming judgment and the eternal punishment reserved for the ungodly. Why are you waiting? Bring on whatever you want. Just awesome. And they tied him to a stake, and they set the stake on fire, and the fire went around him. It didn't consume him. And this happened many times with the martyrs. There was great miracles where lions would just lay down at their feet, or the sword would just bounce off. God worked lots of miracles, but then would eventually let them inherit the crown of martyrdom. And so people seeing this started losing it, and so a soldier came up and pierced him with a spear. Another martyr is St. Cecilia. She was born in Italy, in Rome, lived in the 2nd and 3rd century. She was born to pagan parents, but converted to Catholicism. She made a vow to virginity, but her parents arranged a marriage and forced her to get married, which is its own problem. But on their wedding night, she told her husband, like, I made this vow of virginity, and an angel is guarding my purity. So if you do anything, you touch me, he won't kill you. It's not going to go, but we'll go well. And the guy gets really mad, of course. He's like, what's going on? He says, well, I'm telling you, if you get baptized, the angel will appear and he'll explain. And so he did get baptized. He saw the angel and they became great Catholics. Again, this is a time where it was illegal to be Catholic. And so she was tortured. Her husband converted. And they lived as virgins until death. And she was martyred. And this is a statue that they made of her. And because her head was almost cut off. And she's got her hands like this, the 1 and 3 for the Trinity. And when they exhumed her body several times over the last 2,000 years, they found that her body was incorrupt, it hadn't decayed. 1,700 years, it hadn't decayed. One of the oldest incorrupts of the Church. And this happens from time to time at various levels or various degrees. So usually it's when a body is exhumed to be examined, when a person's in process of canonized, many times the body will be incorrupt. Won't have decayed at all. And then sometimes God will preserve that for years and years and years, or God will let nature take its course, depending on what he wants to do. Like the body of St. Bernadette, still defying the laws of physics, still incorrupt. Sometimes the skin gets dry or something. Because God doesn't want us to put our faith in them, he wants our faith in Jesus Christ. But they are signs. When the body of Blessed Pier Giorgio Frassati was exhumed, they had a picture, they had a photograph before, when he was buried, and a photograph when he was exhumed, and it looks the exact same. It was 25, 50 years later, I can't remember how many years later. It's important to remember that Catholicism, it started with 12, now 1.3 billion, spread all over the world, hundreds of thousands of parishes, billions of people who have been Catholic throughout the ages, following Jesus Christ, receiving, holding to the same faith that he preached 2,000 years ago, receiving the same sacraments that he instituted, being guided by the same leaders, the successors of the apostles. You know, this is all gifts. This is home for us. It's beautiful. And I think 2,000 years, the Catholic Church has outlived any government, any institution. The Catholic Church has outlived it all, right? Be like, oh, this is going to last forever. No, Catholicism will last until Jesus returns. Everything else, up in the air. It's hard for us to imagine 2,000 years. Our country is only a few hundred years old, you know? 1776, you know? Not even 300 years old. 2,000 years old, the Catholic Church. it's going to be here until Jesus returns, right? This is what this is about. It's beautiful to think about. This is home, the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God, which connects us to the kingdom of heaven. Christ established the church here to connect it to the church in heaven. And so let's pray. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So Lord, we thank you for this gift of yourself that you give by coming to earth, taking on our humanity, dying for us, rising from the dead. And the kingdom that you established to bring your salvation, to bring your truth, to bring all that you wish to give us. So please help us to believe, help us to love, help us to follow you. Help us to be good sons and daughters of the kingdom, good sons and daughters of you, Lord God. Lord God, bless this week. Help us to open our hearts to you more and more each day. Help us to know your love. Help us to pray. Help us to be your witnesses, your lights in this world. For you are good and holy, and you started the church to change the world, to make disciples of all nations. Pray for all missionaries throughout the world, all Catholics who are suffering for their faith, all those who are dying for their faith, all our brothers and sisters who may be suffering in poverty, and those who are trying to alleviate it. Please bless all members of your church, Lord. And bless all those who don't know you yet. Draw them home. Draw them to your kingdom. Draw them to yourself. We ask all this through Christ our Lord. Amen. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
All right, God bless you all. Thank you for being here. Have a good night.